And I have the pleasure this morning of introducing Pastor Johnnie, coming all the way from Florida. He did such a good job. We wore him out this weekend, but he so graciously has decided to come, I guess, one more time to preach to you. So,
all right.
As Johnnie comes, give him a warm hand, warm welcome.
Let's go, baby.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for that warm welcome. I need a warm welcome here in Des Moines. This morning, the air, when I came outside to my car, it was not a warm welcome. It was a cold welcome. And I'm not completely foreign to the cold. I did grow up in Kansas City, but I've been in Orlando for a little over 20 years now, so my blood is plenty warm. When I get off the plane there, this afternoon, when I get home, it should be a nice, comfortable 77 degrees or so outside. Oh, come on. Y'all can come with me. Let's just do it. Let's all go together. We'll charter a plane. We'll just make it a party. And I knew I was in trouble yesterday when some of the, actually it was Friday night, some of the guys on the youth team said, "Hey, good news tomorrow." They said, it's warming up. It's getting up to 40. I was like, "That's warm, huh? All right." I mean, when it's 40 in Orlando, you should see it. The newscasts come on and the weather people come out and they say, "Now, don't go outside if you don't have to. You need to go cover all of the plants and just stay inside. It's getting down to, you know, in the mid-40s tonight." And it's just, everybody gets real scared of what's going to happen if the temperature gets that low. So, but man, I have so enjoyed my time here. How many just grateful for a healthy church that you get to come to church? You don't have to come to church. You get to come to church at New Hope. Man, I tell you, I love this church. I love the leadership of this church. I love Pastor Weaver. I've just gotten to know him a little bit this weekend, and I tell you, I sensed just such a shepherd's heart, such a God anointing on his life, and obviously we can look around and see the fruit of faithfulness, and but I tell you, I do sense that this church is a healthy church. Another thing I appreciate about this church is it's a church that believes in and invests in young people, in students, in student ministry, and you don't have to be around here very long to see that. And we had an incredible weekend with the students here, and I love that this church, you know, I believe this on my heart. Students are not the church of tomorrow. Sometimes we make that mistake. They're the church of today. Amen. God has a plan and a hand on their lives, and God's using students here in great ways. God's using the whole team that works with our with the students and all the youth pastors. And I tell you, I travel all over the country, and I am so impressed with what God is doing in this youth ministry. Can you just give some thanks to your youth ministry team, all the youth pastors, all the adults that serve? Yes. Yes, I'm excited for what God is doing in this place, and I'm excited this morning to share God's word as well. I'm praying that that this will be more than just a cute little talk, but that God will speak to you, that there'll be a prophetic anointing on what is said. I say often, I'm not here to talk about God, I'm here to talk for God, and I believe God has a word. I take this assignment so serious and have prayed, and my heart is right, and God's gonna speak to you this morning. I'm gonna speak this morning on the topic of you of greater faith. The you of greater faith. That, I guess, would be the title of my message this morning. And, you know, we don't have, as I mentioned, we don't have quite as much cold weather there in Orlando. But one of the things we do have is we do have some things called hurricanes. I don't know if you've seen on the news when these hurricanes come through, but man, you want to talk about storms that come through. And back in 2004, we had three hurricanes that blew through our area all within about a 6 or 7 week span. And when that first one was coming through, it was August, and it was Hurricane Charlie. They name all the hurricanes. They don't do that for winter storms, but they do it for those. And so it was Hurricane Charlie, and it was kind of starting to project to maybe hit Florida. And so people started getting all scared and just panic and freaking out. And I remember we were kind of driving around that week. We were kind of laughing at it. Oh, man, that's not going to happen. There's no big deal. And Friday comes, and, man, the forecast just keeps getting worse and worse, and everybody's panicking. You go into the grocery stores, I mean, every single aisle is completely empty, lines out everywhere. You couldn't buy batteries. You couldn't buy a piece of wood. You couldn't buy water, bread, nothing. Like, everything was gone. It was like the apocalypse. It was crazy. And so all these people are going crazy. We're just kind of laughing it off, like, oh, even if a hurricane does hit Florida, it's not going to hit Orlando. We're in the center of the state, and maybe the coast might get some damage, but no big deal. Well, as the afternoon went on that Friday, the forecast kept getting worse and worse. That hurricane was getting stronger and stronger every single time they'd go in and give a report on it. So I finally got a little bit serious, a little bit scared. I said, you know what, I probably should at least go in my yard and make sure stuff gets put away. Went in my backyard, and I put my grill into my garage and was picking up any like loose items in the backyard. We had a trampoline there in the backyard, a big old trampoline, and so I kind of thought, well, maybe I should do some with that. I have five kids, believe it or not, so that's why they were little and they loved the trampoline. Five kids, all daughters, believe it or not, all daughters, except for my four sons. But all so four boys and a girl. Sorry about that. And so the trampoline's back there. So I thought, you know what? I need to get that trampoline. So I had this bright idea. I said, what I'll do is I'll turn the trampoline over on its bounciness, you know, like, and then there won't be anything for the wind to catch. So that's a good idea. So I go out there, and I mean, I'm working every strength I got, every angle I got. I'm trying to pull it and push it and turn it. I'm trying to get it flipped over. I'm pulling muscles I didn't even know I had. And I just could not get the thing turned over. It was so big, so heavy, so awkward. So I came to the conclusion, man, there's nothing. If I can't get this thing turned over, there's no way this storm is going to mess with it. Why are you laughing? Don't jump ahead of the story. So we get in the bedroom that night, and the hurricane comes that Friday night. It's all dark outside, and I mean, when it comes, it was come through, and that hurricane did come right through Orlando, and man, it was so powerful. And you would look outside every once in a while, and we had all of our kids in our bedroom all together, but we'd look outside every once in a while, kind of see what was going on, and it was real dark, but the lightning would strike every so often, and you could kind of see, you know, what was going on out there. So one of the times the lightning was striking, and I could see that some of my fence had completely blown down, and I was like, oh man, there goes our fence. And then lightning struck, I'm looking in my backyard, and one of our trees is completely flipped over in the backyard. I said, oh man, there goes one of our trees. That wind just keeps pounding. And one of the times I'm looking out my window back there, and the lightning flashed, and I was like, that's interesting. I didn't notice my trampoline there during that lightning flash. So I wait for the next lightning flash, and that was a long lightning flash, and I look, sure enough, my trampoline is not there at all. So at that point, I don't know where it is, but I'm not going to go out and find it right now. So we just go through the night, and we make it, and the morning comes, and when a hurricane blows through, man, it's nice weather. The moment it's gone, because those storms just pull all of the bad weather into them. So when that hurricane was gone that next morning, it was birds singing and sunshine, and it was awesome. And so we decided to go out and kind of check out the neighborhood and see the damage, and also perhaps see if maybe there was a trampoline anywhere. You know, like, who knows? So we're on our bicycles, me and a couple of my kids, and we're driving in our neighborhood, and we go down my street like this, and then we go up a street, and then we go over a street. So I'm a good, like, probably two blocks, block and a half from my house. And as we're going, there's people outside cleaning up debris everywhere. And as we're riding our bikes, there we notice, as we're coming up on this little corner area, this mangled mess of metal and canvas and trampoline gear and all just mangled in this big mess. And as we're riding towards it, my kids are like, Daddy, look, it's our. And I'm like, be quiet, kids. Just keep driving. Just keep, just head, look up. I didn't know what kind of damage that trampoline had done, and I did not want to be responsible in that moment. I'm like, we'll just wait and hear the stories and decide whether we want to throw our name into the involvement here. I get back to my house, and so I started looking at the trajectory. I'm like, okay, it probably landed there. So, and I start looking, and as I'm looking at the possible trajectory. I noticed the house behind us, quite a ways away, the second story. I noticed there's this big chunk of the house taken out up on the second story. I'm like, I'll bet that was my unidentified flying object that hit the house. Can you imagine being in that house when that happens, man? And so I noticed something else during that storm. I noticed something about my life. I noticed something about faith during that storm. Here's what I noticed about faith in that storm. I noticed that I strongly, strongly, strongly believe in electricity. Electricity was out all over the city during that storm. Some areas were out as many as 10 days, 2 weeks. I think in our area, we were without electricity for probably 4 days, maybe five, I can't remember. But I know that all during that time where the electricity was out, it was hot, it was August, and I would go into these rooms, and I knew the electricity was out because it was so uncomfortable, and it would be dark, of course, no lights on anywhere. And I'd walk into a room, and I would hit the light switch every time. And I would think, why am I hitting the light switch? I know that's not going to do anything. And I'd do what I had to do in the room, and I'd be walking out of the room, and I'd hit the light, turn the lights off. I'm like, why am I turning the lights off? They're already off. And then I walk into the next room and I flip the lights on. And then I go into the bathroom and I flip the lights on. Nothing happens. For days, I'm flipping light switches all the time and nothing happens. You know why I keep flipping light switches? Because I believe in electricity. Because I've gotten so conditioned to believe that when I hit that switch, something's going to happen. That's faith. That's faith. And faith can even take me past times when I hit it and it doesn't work. But if faith is strong enough, I can hit it when it doesn't work and I'll still hit it the next time. Why? Because I believe. Like even when things don't make all that much sense. Like Pastor Weaver was just talking about with healing. Though we may not understand why God doesn't heal in every single situation the way we would maybe think that he should or pray that he should. You know what faith says? Faith says, I'm going to keep praying. I'm going to keep believing. I'm going to keep trusting God no matter what happens in this particular situation because that's what faith is. I'm going to talk about the you of greater faith this morning, and as I do, I certainly do not do so to beat you down. I do it to build you up, man. We look at what greater faith looks like and what greater faith could look like in us, and we do it to build you up and to that we could get to the point that we would be that person, like that I would be the me of greater faith, that our faith would grow in this place today. Hebrews chapter 11. And we'll go to Hebrews chapter 11 and also to Matthew chapter 8. So Hebrews chapter 11 and Matthew chapter 8. Once you get there to Hebrews chapter 11, say, I got it. Are you there? Hebrews chapter 11, say, I got it. All right, and then Matthew chapter 8. Also, we're going to read from Matthew chapter 8. And let's go to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. It'll be up on the screens on those giant Bibles behind me right there. It is verse number 1. Look what it says. It says, now faith is, so this is what faith is. Faith is the confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. That's what the New International Version is. Confidence in what we hope for and it's assurance. Another version says evidence of what we don't yet see. So that's faith. So I'm hitting light switches, assurance, confidence. I don't see the lights coming on, but yet that's I expect it to. That's faith. If we go down to verse 6 in this chapter on faith, it has a profound, powerful statement. It says, and without faith, it's impossible to please God. It's not even an option for us to go, I'm just going to do my thing. I'm just going to do life, and I'm not going to really believe God to intervene in my life. I think God's probably too busy. He's got too much going on. It's an impossibility for us to please God if we don't walk in some level of faith. So it says, without faith, it's impossible to please God because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists. Pause real quick. That one's easy for us. We can look around and go, probably there's a higher power. Probably God had to be involved in all this, just the creation. We can look at the tide. We can look at the, we can look at the human body. Just the amazing aspects of science and whatever. Like God exists. We believe that part, but this is the second part that we have a tough time with sometimes in our faith. We must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. See, here's what happens. Sometimes with faith, we go, yes, God exists. Yes, God does stuff for people. yes, God's active in some people's life. It's just that he doesn't seem to really get active in my life. It's just that God probably doesn't really care what I'm going through. We got to not only believe that he exists, but we got to believe that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. That's how we get to the you of greater faith. And we see in Matthew chapter 8, the disciples are trying to get to that point. Trying to get that point of greater faith in Jesus. And they go through a bit of a storm, and that storm teaches them a little bit about their faith. And in verse 23, that's what we'll read from Matthew chapter 8, verse 23. It says, then he got into the boat. Any guess who he is right there? Jesus. It's always a safe answer in church. All right. If somebody asks you a question, just say Jesus. He's always the right answer. Amen. So yes, Jesus got into the boat and the disciples followed him. Suddenly, furious storm came up on the lake so that the waves swept over the boat, but Jesus was sleeping. The disciples went and woke him, saying, Lord, save us. We're going to drown. He replied, you of little faith. There it is. You of little faith. And we've all been there. Man, some of us are there right now. If we had to be wearing a title today, some of us would be like, I guess I'm probably more on the little faith side than I am the greater faith side. So were they. He says, you of little faith, why are you so afraid? Then he got up and he rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm. And the men were amazed, and they asked, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. Let's pray together and ask God's anointing on his word today. Father, these remaining couple of minutes we have, I pray that you would speak strong in our lives. I pray, God, that your word would literally come to life in us. I pray, Jesus, that as we look in your word, that we would see faith rise up for our situation. We would see faith rise up for where we are right now. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. I heard a great story of faith about a married couple. They had been married for 40 years. They were celebrating their 40th wedding anniversary. They got married when they were 20 years old. And of course, now they were older, a little grayer, and celebrating their 40th anniversary. And God was so pleased with their faithfulness to each other and their faithfulness to him all those years that God sent a messenger to this couple. And the messenger said, I'm so pleased with you. I'm pleased with your commitment to one another. Married for 40 years. You guys got married young at age 20. And I'm so proud of the commitment you've had to me and to each other. And so God said, I'm gonna answer one prayer for each of you today. Like whatever you ask for, I'm gonna answer your prayer. So the wife hears this. The husband's a little skeptic at that point. He's just, I'm not sure if this is real, whatever. The wife, she goes right to her knees and starts praying. She says, Lord, for these 40 years that we've been married, I've always wanted to go on a Caribbean cruise. And I mean, literally, she's praying that. She gets those words out of her mouth and poof, right in her hand, there's the tickets for the cruise right there in her hands. And the husband sees that. He can't believe it. He's like, oh my goodness. So then he drops down to his knees immediately. He said, Lord, I've always wanted to be married to somebody 30 years younger than me. And poof, just like that, he was 90 years old. Just right there as he prayed. So now that we have a complete understanding of what faith is and how dangerous it can be. So let's spend a few minutes in Matthew chapter 8 and see what it would take for us to get to the greater faith, to get to the you of greater faith. I read in verse 23 and 24, look at it again. Verse 23 and 24, it says, then he got in the boat, Jesus got in the boat, and his disciples followed him. They followed Jesus onto a boat. And suddenly a furious storm comes on the lake so that the waves swept over the boat, but Jesus was sleeping. I would say this, for you to be the you of greater faith, there's got to be a commitment when you follow Jesus. You've got to be committed to the process of following Jesus. Because I want you to notice something, that Jesus gets in the boat, and so did they. Now, they were going to an area that you could get to by land. Nobody would have thought anything if Jesus had said, hey, we're going to the Gadarenes, and so let's take this trail right here. It's this road and this road, and they would circle around. Nobody would have thought anything about him going that way to the region that they were going. But Jesus gets into a boat, and so they get into the boat with him. And I don't know, this is a little bit unusual, but they get into a boat, and Jesus knows the storm's coming. Like, Jesus is getting into a boat and they're getting ready to get out into this water, into this this body of water. And the Sea of Galilee, it was about 13 miles long and about 8 miles wide. And it was not uncommon for storms to get violent on that body of water. And Jesus gets in and they get in with him into a boat. See, sometimes we make the mistake of thinking that if I follow Jesus, if I really follow, if I'm right with Jesus, if I really know Jesus, then I'll never have a storm in my life. But see, some of us in this room, we've been serving God long enough to know that that's not true. And unfortunately, I've known some people. And there may be somebody sitting in this room today that would fall into this category. That maybe you had a season in your life where you came to God. Maybe you had gotten yourself in all kinds of storms. Maybe you had been doing your own thing and going your own way and you found that your life was a mess. Let me just pause and say this. There's a difference between storms that I get myself into and storms that I go through with Jesus. And I will take a storm with Jesus in my boat over a storm by myself that I got myself into any day of the week. And so some of us have gotten ourselves in that kind of mess. And we come to Jesus and we say, Jesus, if I give you my life and if I try to serve you and if I try to be obedient to you, then I want all nothing but sunny skies. I want nothing but butterflies flying around and birds chirping. I expect everything to be perfect. And then one storm comes and one rough time comes and you look at God and you go, God, how can you do this to me? And that one storm breaks your commitment to Christ. Man, anybody, when the sun's shining and the birds are singing and everything's perfect, anybody can worship, anybody can praise God, anybody can trust, anybody can stay committed. But when the storm comes, your commitment has to be true to him. Because watch this, Jesus could have prevented the storm altogether, but he didn't. He allows them to sail into the storm. Could it be that the storm, was for their sake? Could it be that he was getting ready to show them something in the midst of a storm? I read about this crazy scientific experiment. It's called the Biosphere 2. They built this whole like little enclosed world kind of a thing. And these scientists committed to live. They sequestered themselves inside the Biosphere 2 for 2 years. They were going to live in there for 2 years. It was outside of Oracle, Arizona. And so they go in for 2 years, and inside this Biosphere 2, there it is, inside there, they replicated almost a lot of different earthy areas, a lot of different scenarios in there. Like, they created a rainforest inside the biosphere. They created a desert area. They were able to even get it to rain inside there. They even created an ocean inside the biosphere. So they're trying to like replicate all of these different aspects of nature in this enclosed setting. But one of the things that they could never replicate, no matter what they did with the amount of water and what was going on in the air, the one thing that they could not ever replicate was wind. They could never create the right elements and the right environment where wind would start to blow inside the biosphere. Now, they had vegetation, they had everything, all kinds of stuff growing. And they found that after some time, the trees were growing in this biosphere. But after a year and a half, they started to notice something. These trees, as they started to grow taller, all of a sudden they just started to wilt over. That they started to just break right in the middle. And at first they didn't understand what was going on until I realized that in this windless environment, in this environment that had no wind, as these trees were growing up with no wind to resist against, that though they were growing taller, but the trunks weren't growing strong enough to support the length that the trees were growing. And because the environment was too safe, because the environment was too easy, The trees were just falling over and dying. I also read about shipmakers back in the day when they would want to build a great ship, and they would look for the right tree to be the mast there in their ship. So they would go out into forests and they would find the right tree that they think that looks like the strongest tree, that's going to be the strongest wood. And when they found the tree that they wanted to use for their mast, they would cut down all the trees around it. They wouldn't cut down that tree. No, they would cut down all the trees around it, leaving that tree even more exposed to the elements, leaving that tree even more exposed to the storms. And then they'd go away for a while, and that tree would withstand even more storms and more wind and more elements. And they'd come back after some time, now that tree even stronger than it was before, and cut it down and use it for their great mast. I tell you, it'll change your mindset. When there's a commitment to follow Christ, even when I go through storms, at least I know this. I may go through a storm. If I follow Christ, it doesn't prevent the storms. You know what it does? It adds purpose to my storms. It adds a reason why I'm going through it. I know that if God sees fit to allow me to walk through a tough season, if God sees fit to allow me to have something happen with my job, if God sees fit to have something happen with my body, have something happen in my health, if God sees fit, I know this, that he's gonna teach me something as I walk through this. There's gotta be a commitment to him as we follow. We go on in verse 25 and 26. Jesus says, the wave swept over the boat. Jesus is sleeping. So the disciples went in, they woke him, and they said, "Lord, save us. We're drowning. We're going to drown." I mean, the disciples go straight for the worst case scenario. They're like, they didn't say, "Jesus, I don't know if you know, there's like, it's the winds blowing and stuff." They just went straight for the kill shot. They say, "Hey, by the way, Jesus, I don't know if you're asleep and stuff, but we're going to die. Just want to let you know, say your goodbyes. We're all going to die. Just want to let you know." And this is the only time in scripture that even mentions that Jesus was sleeping, was right here. It's the only time, I'm sure he did, but this is the only time it's mentioned, probably a little bit for effect. He goes in and goes to sleep. They come in panicked, calling on Jesus out of fear. They say, "We're going to drown." And he replies to them, "You of little faith, why are you so afraid?" Then he got up and he rebuked the winds and the waves, and it was completely calm. It's good to know that even when sometimes it seems like Jesus is not paying attention, even though it seems like sometimes God's not active in your life, sometimes it feels like maybe he's off asleep somewhere, he's not. And I want you to notice that Jesus did not rebuke the wind and the waves first. The storm is going crazy. The storm is so bad that the disciples assume they're going to die, but Jesus does not calm the storm first. First, before he rebukes the winds and the waves, he rebukes them. First, he says, you of such little faith, why are you so afraid? And I love it that he's saying this in the midst of the storm. The boat is going all over the place. But Jesus takes the first moment to rebuke them. See, sometimes God wants to do something in you before he does something for you. I believe sometimes he'll leave us in a storm if it means we're going to learn something in the process. I believe sometimes he'll leave us in a bit of trial and tribulation if it means we're going to be stronger and we're going to believe in him and it's going to change our perspective a little bit. I believe that with all my heart. And so first, before God does something for you, sometimes he's trying to do something in you. And Jesus rebukes them before he rebukes the wind and the waves. See, I believe this, is sometimes we want Jesus to fix our problems, but Jesus first wants to fix our perspective. Because we can get so focused on the outcome, we can get so focused on the storm, we can get so focused on the worst case scenario that even when we call on Jesus, we're not calling out of confidence. See, when you call on Jesus, there's a way to do it. And we're supposed to call on him with confidence. But we sometimes can get so focused on the storm, so focused on the problems, so focused on the issues, that even when we come to Christ, we're coming with a defeatist attitude. We're coming saying, "Well, I guess it's all over, and I guess we're going to die." I was playing in a golf tournament a couple months ago. I don't play a ton of golf. I used to play a lot when I was younger and didn't have as many kids and had more time. But I play maybe two or three times a year. But we were playing in this pastor's tournament in town where we live, and a couple of the guys from our staff were playing together. One of the guys that was playing, he is not very good at golf. Like, I'm not that good anymore at this point, but he's really not that good. Like, all right. So, and that day, he was having a particularly rough day on the golf course. So he's not that good, and then he was also having a bad day on top of that. I'm telling you, he was losing golf balls so fast, like, I think they had to up manufacturing because somebody sent word to, like, you know, Titleist, say, hey, you may need to get going because this guy is going through all of them. He just kept, it seemed like every ball he hit would go in the water. This, I mean, it was crazy. It was amazing. It was almost magical. I'm like, how do you do this? I mean, he was hitting water on holes that didn't have any water. It was amazing. It'd be like sailing off. And I didn't even, what's that? Yeah, it's awesome. And one time he's getting ready to hit halfway through the day. He gets up on the tee box and he's just nervous. He's at the point that he's pulling out the oldest raggedy golf ball he can find because he just assumes it's going to get lost. And he puts it down and he's standing over his golf ball. He's getting ready to hit. And I'm just kind of standing behind him looking, getting ready for my shot. And he's standing there and I hear him under his breath. I hear him going, don't go in the water. 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 His pre-shot routine had become a chant of don't go in the water, don't go in the water, don't go in the water. And I kid you not, he's saying that, and I'm watching him. We kind of start laughing that he's saying that. I look up because I'm looking up to think, I didn't even know there was water on this hole. Now watch. I had been looking at my shot, but I hadn't even noticed the water. You know what I was looking at? I was looking at the fairway. I was looking at where I wanted my ball to land. Now, don't get me wrong. My ball doesn't go where I want it to go every time, but sometimes it does. But I'll say this. Every time I get ready to hit, I'm planning on it going there. So I was focused on where it was supposed to go. He's focused on what he doesn't want to happen. And he's saying, don't let it go in the water. Don't let it go in the water. And then for the first time, I'm struggling. Oh, I guess there is water on this hole. So I said, Lester, you can't say that. He goes, what do you mean? I don't want it to go in the water. I said, yeah, but what you're focusing on, you're spending all your energy on, I promise that's where it's going to go. We may figure out why your ball keeps going in the water all day. And it's the same with life. That you know what? You spend all your time and energy focusing on your problems. Guess what? All that happens is your problems get bigger and stronger. You spend, and there's people that you can find that'll help you do that. I mean, you can find worst case scenario people. They're everywhere. You can find those kind of people that you're with, you know, you say, man, I got a headache. And they say, it's probably a tumor. Like, you can find those people. They're everywhere. Say, man, I don't know where he is. I wonder if they got in an accident. Like, no, they didn't. He just probably stopped at the store. Like, you can find those worst case scenario people who love to focus on the storm, who love to come and say, well, I guess we're going to die. But the disciples made a mistake in that. Jesus was not rebuking them because they came to him and they called on him. He was rebuking them because they were lost in their fear. He rebuked them because they were so afraid and of such little faith. So be confident when you call on God. Be committed when you follow God. And then the third, like, truth I pull out of this passage as I look at it today in verse 26 and 27, I say this, be convinced when he comes through, and he will come through. Be convinced. And I love the end of this little story in verse 26 and 27. It says, he replies, you have little faith. Why are you so afraid? Then he got up and he rebukes the wind and the waves, and it was completely calm. And the men were amazed, and they asked, what kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him. What kind of man is this? And I love it, because he rebukes the wind, but he also rebukes the waves. And then it's completely calm. When my kids were little, they'd be taking a bath. They kind of had a little game that they tried to do sometimes. They'd turn that bath into a wave pool. And they start going back and forth. Then that water would just start going everywhere. Sometimes we come in after bath time and water is all over the bathroom. We'd be like, how'd this happen? I don't know. But every once in a while, I'd hear them in there starting the wave pool. They'd be going back and forth, getting that water up higher and higher and higher. And sometimes I'd open the door and catch them right in the middle of it. And they'd stop. And they'd look at me all innocent like, hey, The problem was they stopped, but the water didn't. That water was telling on them. That water was evidence, all the evidence I needed. I'd be like, what's going on? I don't know. That water's just going crazy, isn't it? See, though they stopped, the water didn't. And I love that Jesus was so convincing in his intervention. And you got to get this. Jesus was so overwhelming in his involvement in this situation that he speaks to the wind and the storm stops. But the effects of the storm stop too. So not only does the wind stop blowing, but the water stops moving at the moment that he speaks. And it was so overwhelming that it created these disciples were so convinced of the power of Jesus because it was so overwhelming. They had gotten to a place of greater faith that they would never have gotten to had they not gone through the storm. Can I say that one more time? They'd gotten to a place of greater faith that they never would have gotten to if it wasn't for the storm. And now they're looking at each other going, what kind of man is this? That'll happen. When God comes through, when you stay committed enough to follow him even through rough times, and when you call on him with some confidence, what will happen is you'll start to see God come through in some areas, and it'll create a greater faith. You know the people who believe in God? You know the people who really have faith in God? It's the people who have seen God calm the storm. It's the people who have seen God bring the healing. It's the people who have seen God bring the family back together. It's the people who have seen God come through with a financial miracle. It's the people who have seen God and said, God, I'm asking for unmerited favor. I know I don't deserve it, but God, I'm just praying you'd open the door for this job. And boom, that job comes through. That person starts to understand the power of prayer. I don't have time to go into detail, but I had a major, major illness hit me about 10 or 11 years ago. Came home one night. I was getting numb on my body on one side all the way down the other. I'm freaking out. I said, I don't know what's going on. Like my numbness, I feel that I'm going numb. And my wife goes, oh, great, you're probably having a stroke. She's really compassionate like that. Got somebody come to the keyboard. So she's like, you're probably having a stroke. I was like, well, I'll go look. So I go to the computer because that's what you're supposed to do during a medical emergency is go to WebMD. I go to the computer and I'm trying to type in like stroke symptoms and I'm hitting the letter and I'm looking up and I can't like make out what's going on the screen. And so then I go back to backspace and I'm just trying to type and I'm not the greatest typer in the world, but usually I'm a good backspacer. I couldn't even find the backspace key. Finally, I type in the word stroke symptom. Like I can't even figure it out. She's like, what are you doing? I said, I don't know. Like I can't. So I finally get it all typed in, and it's there they are, stroke symptoms. And I mean, I'm reading a checklist. It's like numbness, especially on one side of the body. I'm like, check. Disorientation. I'm like, I'm so disoriented. I don't know, but I think I'm disoriented. Like every single one was right there, all the symptoms. And so we end up rushing to the hospital, and I completely just go incoherent, basically go into like a coma state for about 36 hours, and they don't know what's going on. They were going to give me blood thinner because they thought it was a stroke, and at the last second, one of the doctors says, no, I don't think it's, I think it's something else going on. So they're rushing me in all kinds of tests and all kinds of things, and one of the doctors at one point looked at my wife and said, this isn't good. They didn't know what it was, and I have these little tiny windows of memories from that. And that was Sunday night. And then Tuesday morning, in the midst of them running all the tests, in the midst of them trying to figure out what was going on, Tuesday morning, I wake up. See, now what had happened in between Sunday night and Tuesday morning is people began to pray and believe for a miracle in my life like crazy. My students had filled up that waiting room and that chapel at that hospital. They were there almost all hours of the day. There was people there praying for me. People from my church, people from my churches everywhere were praying for me. Tuesday morning, I wake up with absolutely no symptoms, no anything. I wake up, I'm just like hungry and ready for a Diet Coke. Like I'm ready, I'm back to normal. And they said, well, what's going on? They had people wearing masks and quarantined if they had been around me. They didn't know what was going on. So finally, as they discharged me the next day on Wednesday, they kind of say, well, I mean, it had all the symptoms. What we thought was encephalitis and meningitis. That's what we thought it was, both. I ended up going back to my doctor for a checkup a few weeks later. I had the privilege of sitting down with the doctor for him to say, we never did quite figure out what was going on with you, did we? He said, you just kind of like everything just stopped. And we never did figure out why, did we? And I had the privilege of saying, oh no, I figured it out. I said, see, people were praying for me all over the country, man, and God just completely healed me. That's what happened. He said, well, amen. Like he didn't know what to say to that Jewish doctor. He was agreeing with me. But I'm telling you, going through that little storm and seeing God come through with that much power, with that much thoroughness. Like God not only calmed my storm, but the effects of the storm. I know some people who've suffered those same illnesses and those same situations. And I know one pastor, he was not even able to hardly communicate, lost his memory, had to do all kinds of rehabilitation. And I just thank God. And I tell you, when you walk through something like that, it just changes your perspective, changes your level of faith. And I believe that there's some people in this room and you're going through a storm. Some of us, maybe it's a storm of our own making. But some of us, it's a storm that Christ has seen fit for us to go through. I don't know what it is for each individual in this room. Maybe it is something financial. Maybe it's something that's just an attack on your mind. Maybe it's a spirit of depression and you're having thoughts that you thought you'd never have. Maybe your marriage is going through the worst storm it ever has. I tell you this, stay committed to following Christ. Call on him with confidence and you'll be convinced that he still calms storms. Let's do this all over this room. Will you bow your heads and close your eyes? Everybody in this place, I sense God in this room and he's here for a reason. And I want to tell you something before we close this service out. It's okay not to be okay. It's okay to go through a storm. You going through a storm does not mean that you're in trouble. It does not mean that you're out of God's will. You going through a storm does not mean necessarily that you did something wrong. Because it could be an opportunity where God's really wanting to show up in your life. How many in this room would say this today, Pastor? Like, I have been going through something and it's caused me to get my eyes off of Christ. It's caused me to be to get worried. It's caused me to get fearful. I'm going through a serious issue. Maybe it's something going on with your kids and you've been so worried about it and you're walking through this storm. You say, you know what? I just need Jesus Christ to show up in my life in a very real way because of the storm I'm going through. I just need today to ask him again to calm it. I just need today to go to him and with confidence and know that he's going to not only calm the storm, but he's going to calm the effects of the storm in my life. And I just need that today. You know who you are. If that's you today and you say, you know what, just pray for me as we close this service out. If that's you, hold up your hand real quick and let me just see it. I'm going through something that I just need the providence of God. I need the intervention of God. Come on, who else in this room is going through something? You say, just remember me as we close this service out in prayer. Amen. Hands all over this room. God bless you. You can put your hands down. I have one more question to ask. With nobody looking around, maybe somebody's in this room, and I believe there are many. You find yourself in kind of more the storms of your own making. Maybe you've been going your own way, doing your own thing. Maybe you thought you didn't need God. Maybe it's gotten you to a place in life where you realize that you do need somebody to follow. Maybe you're at a place that you don't know that you do need the forgiveness of a Savior who loves you and died for you. Maybe you're outside of relationship with God and maybe he brought you here for this very reason, just to hear him say one more time, come on, follow me. Let me guide you. Let me help you. Let me be your strength. If you're in this building today and you're outside of relationship with God, really no matter how old you are, son, daughter, mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, if you're outside a relationship with God, you don't want to leave this place. You don't want to go face that storm without him. You don't. So if you're in this building, you're outside a relationship with God and you know you need him today, I'm going to ask you to do something as well. I'm going to ask you to lift your hand in a moment. I just will pray for you and include you as we close this service out. But if you're in this building today, you say, I'm outside a relationship with God and I know it. I know I need Jesus Christ to be Lord of my life again. If that's you, hold your hand up and let me pray for you. I'm outside a relationship with God. Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you. In every section. Anybody else? I'm outside a relationship with God and I know I need him. God bless you. You can put your hands down. Why don't we do this? Everybody in this room, stand to your feet. And as we all stand to our feet today, I tell you, I want to end this service believing. I want to end this service with greater faith. Like, I want us to so believe that when we hit the light switch, the lights are coming on. When we call on Jesus with confidence, he's going to come through. I want to believe with you. And there were hands that went up all over this building saying, I'm going through a storm, and I just want you to do something. I want you to step out of that storm and of that situation. And in a moment, the worship team is going to lead us in this song and that we sang a moment ago about how powerful the name of Jesus is. In a moment, when they begin to lead us, I want you to step out and come to this front. If you lifted your hands and said, I'm going through a storm and I just need the intervention of God, we just want to pray with you and believe with you. The church staff and the church prayer team, man, we're ready for God to just come through. We're ready for God to heal. We're ready for God to reconcile your family and bring a financial, whatever it is that you're going through, we're ready for that. But also, if you lifted your hand a moment ago saying you're outside a relationship with God, take this opportunity as well. I invite you to come as we begin to sing as well.